Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your word that is so rich. There's layers upon layers upon layers that we are going to dig down into today. We look forward to that. But more than just studying the map, we want to travel the road. So Heavenly Father, I pray that you'll help us to be able to listen to what you want us to know, to what you want us to hear. And if there's anything evil around here that's trying to block our minds or fog us, we come against you in the powerful name of Jesus Christ. You have no place here. You must flee in Jesus' name. And the Spirit of God, we invite you to come and be our teacher. I look forward to this, what you are going to do this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Our creative team was brainstorming what we should do with this new series. And the thing that came up, what actually popped up, was the idea that we sometimes are on the computer and these pop-up ads come, and they come from nowhere, and you go, where did that come from? What was I searching to deserve this? Like, it happens on Christian sites. I remember I was trying to research some things, you know, getting Bible verses, and this thing came up, logo software, and I tried to read it, and it's something like, you know, 10 small payments of $300. I could get all the resources that I could look up anyway on the web. And I go, wow, I don't believe these things. We easily delete, get out, X, get out. We're used to this. Get out of that way as fast as we can. But there is something in our relationship that happened to each one of us. There are these emotions that just come up, and they seem to come up out of nowhere. And it's not just you. It's just not your spouse where this happens. It happens to each one of us. This guilt, where did that come from? This anger, like, why am I angry all of a sudden? Or why am I envious of that person? Why am I all of a sudden despondent? And it just pops up on the screen. And the problem with us, though, is that often we press the accept button. We often press the accept button. And this series, basically, at the baseline of this, is we need to learn not to believe every thought or emotion that just pops up. We actually have to guard our hearts. We have to actually take each one of these thoughts and emotions to God. Many of these emotions create toxic reactions, and they compete for control of my mind, my heart, and my relationships. So how can these emotions not be the boss of me? We're going to take 4 weeks to try and just dig down in this and discover this. If you think this would be helpful for someone in your life, in your world, please bring them on out next week as we continue to hit emotion after emotions. So first thing, where do these emotions come from? Where do these things that pop up out of nowhere come from? We want to say, well, that wasn't me. I wasn't thinking about that. That somehow I just came from the ether. I don't know why I said that. I don't know why I felt that. Where do these pop-up emotions come from? Well, Jesus actually talked about this. And he had a long, drawn-out discussion with Pharisees about this very thing. The Pharisees were just on his case about why he doesn't wash his hands before a meal. And you think, are they like his mother? No, it's like a very ceremonial kind of washing. And I saw it in Jerusalem. It's fascinating where they have a running tap, a big sort of open running tap before the Wailing Wall. And you'll see these Hasidic Jewish men with the hats and the sideburns, and they'll come and wash their hands, and they have to like dry them off three times. And so this was the usual thing. And what happens, Jesus and his dudes, they just go, we're going to go in to worship. We're going to eat. And they say, well, why don't you do these things? Because these things are written in their tradition. And so Jesus launches off, and he doesn't say, oh, sorry, I was wrong. Guys, you need to wash your hands. He was not into false guilt. But this is what he said in Matthew chapter 15, verse 16 to 20. He says, do you not understand yet, Jesus said. Anything you eat passes through the stomach and goes into the sewer. He's doing a junior high talk at this moment. He says, listen, anything you eat just comes out the other. You're a tube, man. That's all you are. So whatever you eat, it doesn't matter how clean it is. It's not like pigs are dirty things anymore. He's now sort of setting out a whole new law. And they're going, what? How can this be? You mean we get to eat bacon? And I'm sure all this thing is going through. Well, it doesn't matter what you eat. That's not the thing that defiles you. And then he says these things. But the words you speak come from your heart. And that's what defiles you. This is a heart issue. And the things that come out of your mouth, not things that you put into your mouth, actually defile you and a lot of people around you. We know that, right? One whisper, one word, even a question somebody can ask can start to defile many people around us. But the words come from your heart, and that's what defiles you. For from the heart comes evil thoughts. Murder, adultery, all sexual immorality, theft, lying, and slander. These are what defile you. He's basically saying everything that the law is about, it starts not with action. It starts way back. It starts back with what you think about. It starts back with how your heart is. It starts there. We've seen this on Facebook posts. I know I've seen it, and I thought I'll throw it up now. No, we've all seen it. The idea is you have a mug of coffee, right? And somebody bumps into you, and you spill coffee on them, and you say, "Wow, you made me spill coffee." Well, you might have made them spill, but coffee, that's what was in the mug. The deal is, if somebody bumps into you and you have water in the mug, you spill water. If somebody bumps into you and you have coffee, you spills coffee. If somebody bumps into you and you're a toxic heart, toxics come out. If your heart is good and somebody bumps into you, Skittles come out. It's good. Skittles. I needed to have bags of Skittles just to throw out to you all. What is in our heart will eventually spill out on those who are closest to us. If you don't believe it, that your own heart is the origin, you know that's the case with your parents, isn't it? Your parents' hearts spilt out on each other and eventually on you. So where do these pop-up emotions come from? That discouraging news is they come from your heart. They come from somewhere in your heart. These emotions, some from your history, some the evil one presses again, but the evil one always presses buttons that you have somewhere in your heart. Our culture assumes that everyone is born good. We had a party at my house, and there was an interesting little theological debate in the corner, and I said, "So are people basically good or basically bad?" Okay, this is a good debate, and I stood back and listened to what they're saying back and forth. Our culture out there, what we will hear bombarded all the time, that everyone is good. Everyone is basically good. You came out of the womb perfect, and maybe some trauma made you turn a little bit bad, and we start to look for blame about all the different things that made you turn bad. But our culture would tell you came out of the womb amazing, perfect. And that's why we all need to go back to our childhood. That's why we want to go and hear what children have to say, because they are so close to not being bad. This is what we do. We all were born good. Let's read the Bible. There's a verse in Jeremiah 17:9. It's a beautiful, encouraging verse. It says this: the human heart is more deceitful than all things. Amen. And desperately wicked. Who really knows how bad it is? Isn't that awesome? And we can all say, amen. Here's the deal. If you have kids, who taught them to say no? That miraculously popped out of somewhere, right? Who taught them to lie? Okay, if you don't tell the truth, no. They just come on, stumble on it naturally. How's that? Because our heart, actually, the right answer to the question, is it evil or good, is yes. Every person on this planet is created by God in God's image. And so we have goodness in us. We all have goodness for great art. We have goodness for great capacity to love. We are all created in the image of God as good. But we've all fallen, and we were all sort of in Adam and Eve, and that fallenness has come to everyone. And so we're all skewed. We all have broken hearts. Nobody's heart is perfect, no matter how young or how old, no how many wonderful things you haven't gone through. We are all broken. And so the answer is yes. What, are we good? Yes. Are we bad? Yes. We both are. We're in the image of God and we are broken. And so from these broken hearts comes love. But from the same broken heart comes anger and despondency and bitterness that you have all experienced from the people around you. For the next 4 weeks, we are going to be picking off at least four of these emotions and saying, God, do you have anything that you can tell us about when this emotion comes out of my heart and it just pops out and it spills on my family and friends, what I can do to stop it? What can I do to try and fix it, maybe even heal it? I'm excited about this. I think this next 4 weeks, it's going to be exciting for you personally, for those who are closest to you. I think we're going to dig down and actually have some relational wholeness if we can start to walk with some of these. Okay, the first one we're going to talk about is guilt. As a great drama, our Masis did that drama. That's the first time he did drama. Let's give it up for him. Woo! Yeah. You're good, man. You're good. It's guilt. Guilt is the emotion of acknowledging that we have done something wrong. We have done something wrong. You feel guilty because you've done something wrong. There is false guilt. False guilt. Some of you have been brought up with false guilt. I know some parents are really good at creating false guilt. I have this friend, and he was saying, you know, he's working on some computer project, and his mom goes by and says, "Well, we're all cleaning up the living room. I hope you're having fun." And walks away. Right? Isn't that awesome? She's got a PhD in false guilt. Like, come out and say it. Well, you just say, hey, do you want to come and help us clean up for a moment? That's awesome. But some parents are really good at making you feel guilty. Not just parents, but other people that will think that you need to do things. As a leader, I carry around a lightning rod in a thunderstorm. That's what leaders do. We go around and I get shots of all kinds of things I do wrong. And so I got no problem with humility, man. I know I've got all kinds of things done wrong. But if I've done wrong everything that everybody tells me, man, I am such a mess. And so there's false guilt that we all have to come to and say, is this really something I've done wrong? And then there's real guilt. Real guilt. This is when we have done something wrong. And what happens with real guilt? Often this was what happened. We don't know what to do. It throws us off balance. And so when we feel guilty, we create a narrative to try and help us to live with the guilt so it doesn't overwhelm us. My father treated me that way, so it's only natural that I did that. I was only a high school student. Man, when you're in high school, you can get away with anything, right? See the narrative? So it's okay. Yeah, we distance ourselves from this again and again. This is my first job. I didn't know what I was doing. They started it. And that happens more than just on the junior high play yard. It leaves us standing condemned, guilt does. And there's no way to undo the past. We don't know what to do with it. You can't unsay the things that you've said. People remember them. You can't buy back that night. It happened. We can't give the childhood back to our kids that we wanted. We try and distance ourselves from the guilt by these stories. But the thing is, if we tell stories about our guilt, they start to morph. They start to grow. As one psychologist said, if you try and push guilt away, it goes to the basement and lifts weights. And it comes back stronger. It comes back as anger most often. Why? Because you're angry at yourself. You're angry at yourself for being so stupid. And so this anger at yourself just starts to leak, because anger leaks. If you're around angry people, it leaks onto other people. And so we need to get rid of this. The narrative does not help. There's real guilt that sometimes people use, just start to define themselves by. I am not a good person. I'm not worthy of people's attention. Either from false guilt Or hanging on to the things that you did wrong, and you just don't know how to let it go. And so you just take it in, and you beat yourself up, and you don't do things that you'd like to do, and you don't parent the way you should parent, because guess what? I'm messed up. I made my mistakes. They'll make their mistakes. And you back away because You let guilt define you. And then the worst thing of all, there's real guilt in your life, but there's no feeling towards it. The Bible talks about us searing our consciences. It's like you've put out the flame so many times with your thumb. Basically, now you don't feel it anymore. You just don't feel guilty. We want to stay away from that. So Dave, I get it. This is bad news. How do we get rid of this guilt? Well, first of all, let's try and understand that guilt creates a debt-debtor relationship. Every time you do something wrong, you owe somebody. You stole something from someone. We know this just by the language we use. I owe her an apology. Why do you owe it? Because you've actually taken something from her. I don't know how I can make it up to them because you've sensed that you owe them. But often we don't experience guilt as debt, but as a weight. I just feel like there's this weight around me. And I know when people have dealt with guilt, because you know what they say? There's this weight that just lifted off of me. Why? Because you've carried this weight. And as you carry this weight, it throws you off balance in the relationships that you are closest with. It affects our parenting, it affects our marriages, it affects our friendship. It makes you too aggressive, too timid. Okay, Dave, I got the problem. How are we gonna fix this? The Bible is amazing. I love the Word of God. It just digs down and tells you how to handle this one in a big way. There's first thing about guilt in the Bible. There's great news. You know what the news is? We're all guilty. Isn't that awesome? Can I hear an amen? We are all guilty. Take away the narrative. Don't sand off the edges. Each one of us here is guilty. In fact, the scriptures say that. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. You have done that. Isn't that great? As a preacher, I can say you and I can even point my finger. Awesome. Guess what? I am guilty. The five finger, the four fingers come back and point at me. Great. Everyone is. Okay, hold on. Just grab onto a seat. The Pope is guilty. No. Yes. Mother Teresa? Yes. She is a human being. She was guilty too. Welcome to the human race, everyone. Every one of us is guilty. Every one of us. And so, does God just want us to carry around this weight? To throw us off in every relationship? There's a great third option. It's good news. It doesn't have to define you. You don't have to deny it. And I think the Apostle Paul modeled it in such a great way. We're going to read the words of the Apostle Paul. We're going to really focus on Romans chapter 8. But just a little bit, I just want you to know, these are the words from a person who had more regret than anyone else in this room combined, I believe. This was not theory for him. This was his experience. Acts 22:4 says this, and this is Paul telling his own story. I worked hard. How'd you work hard, Paul? What was your job success rate here? What did you reach your targets? All right? Yeah, he reached his targets. And killed men and women who believed as I believe. He's now standing on the other side of belief today. I put them in chains and sent them off to prison. Do you notice how much he sands off the guilt of his narrative? Do you notice how much he backs away and says, but you know what? I really didn't know what I was doing. But you know what? I was drunk at the time. You know what? I was in my 20s and you just can't, you know. No, he said, listen, I separated families. I took men and women off in chains. I left their crying children at home. I did this to them. And not only that, I put them to death. I saw them stoned. I saw them, we buried their bodies in this open grave. And it's not just men, but women too. And you say, Paul, stop talking. How can you just say this? But somehow he didn't try and sugarcoat it, didn't sand off the rough edges, didn't create a narrative around it. In fact, it was something that he didn't forget either. And we'll come back to when guilt pops up again. He didn't forget it. Oh, I can't give you the kicker yet. So good. Hold on and wait. But you start to get a little bit of a piece of it in this next scripture where he describes himself, 1 Timothy 1:15, he's talking to the young man he's mentoring. This is a faithful saying, worthy of all exception, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. You can almost see the pen stop, can't you? Of whom I'm chief. We'll come back to that. He didn't let it define him. He didn't go around beating himself up about it, but he didn't deny it. Didn't stop him serving. But he knew the secret of this beautiful word, and this word is freedom. Freedom. Such a good word, isn't it? Can we just all whisper that together? Not loud, just whisper. Because I think this needs to be whispered in the farthest corner of this building, all right? Can we just whisper freedom here? Ready? 1, 2, 3. Freedom. Okay. It can be a little louder. Okay, here. All right. Let's try this again, right? 1, 2, 3. Freedom. Yeah. Here's a passage I want to dwell on here. It's Romans chapter 8, verses 1 to 2. He's at this pivotal part in the book of Romans. Up to this point, he keeps on telling people, we're messed up. Romans chapter 7, I'm messed up more than everybody. And he comes to Romans chapter 8, and this is what he says. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are, can we read the boldest together? In Christ Jesus. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. You go, hold on. Okay, he's doing theology talk now, Dave. This is starting to get confusing. Let's try and unpack this a little bit. The law has only one job. Any law can only tell you you're guilty. You're guilty, you're guilty, you're guilty. You don't drive and you don't see the police come around with the lights. You know, just me saying this, doesn't that make your heart rate go up a little bit? You pull off and you're going, what did I do wrong? And you're looking for the ownership. You're looking for the insurance. And you roll down and the police officer does not lean in the window and says, you are not guilty. You've done nothing wrong. Wouldn't that be awesome? They should hand you a box of Skittles. I don't know. But the idea is, that's not the job of the law. The law has one job. The only thing the law can do is chase you down, say you're guilty, you're guilty, you're guilty. That's the job of the law. And the Jewish people were living under the law. And so guess what they felt all the time? You're guilty, you're guilty, you're guilty, you're guilty, you're guilty. Because that's the only thing law can do. It can only tell you what you've done wrong. And that's what they lived under, the weight of it, talking about the carrying the weight of guilt. Wrong. And what it says here, and I'm going to read it again. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those, for everybody? No, not for everybody. Those who are in Christ Jesus. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free. We have been set free from the law that says you're condemned, you're condemned, you're condemned. This new law is the freedom of being in Christ. Okay, well, how does it work, Dave? This is how I believe it works. God is the ultimate judge. God is the ultimate judge of the universe. And we've talked about that. We did a whole series on what God is like, right? Isn't that awesome? I remember one of my favorite series this last year, and it was on his holiness and on his justice. He is holy. He is just. You got to look those up online if you haven't heard those. You got to understand who God is. He is the ultimate judge. He is the creator of the ends of the earth. So it's almost like he's created this vast video game, right? I'm trying to speak the language. Okay, so... So we created this vast video game, and somehow the players in the video game keep on trying to use hacks, try to twist the video game and try to do things in ways that he never created to be. And so what's he doing? He's saying, man, you owe me, video game player, because you are hacking my world. You are hacking it in bad and horrible ways. Not only that, but God is the ultimate judge, so everything comes back to him. So every time you lie, you not only hurt the person you're lying, but you've hurt the person who created a perfect world where lies should never be given. And so we read a psalm like this. This is from King David, after he had slept with Bathsheba and killed her husband. not a great stellar start for David in this passage, but listen to what he says. This is his psalm after. Psalm 51, verse 1 to 4. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. That's that chesed we talk about sometimes. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgression. Wash away all my iniquity. Cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgression and my sin is always before me. He carries the weight of that all the time. Notice how he sands the rough edges off? He does not. He stares in the eye of his judge and creator and says, I messed up. I was wrong. And then he says this, against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. Well, hold on. He did a lot of sin to other people, David. We could add up the list. But he's saying, first and foremost, I broke your laws. First and foremost, I broke your heart. First and foremost, I broke your creation. First and foremost, I went against you, my judge. Against you, and you only, have I sinned and done what's evil in your sight. So you are right when in your verdict and justified when you judge. This is real humility. No kind of narrative built around it. What is King David depending on? He's depending on the hope that was coming, that Jesus Christ, God's perfect son, who is not guilty of anything. God sent Jesus down here to show us how to live, yes. To show us how to love, yes. But so much more. On the cross, he took my sin, the payment for my sin. Even better than that, he took my guilt and my shame. He suffered shame that we should be feeling. It's just not the legal Xing off of our sin. If you hear about Roman crucifixion, it's worse than the Passion movie, all right? Because they had to do some things just to keep it within some levels there. But when they were killed, they were only killed really off, they say 2-3 feet off the ground, so you can look at them in the eye, and they're stripped naked. So Jesus, even, you know, on all the pictures, got the loincloth thing on, right? Because, you know, PG crucifixion. But he's like stripped naked in front of everybody's passing by a roadway, so everybody could see what's going on. So not only what did he carry my sin, he carried my shame. He carried my guilt. That's what my Jesus did. And he says this, 1 John 1:9. He says, Dave, listen to me, Dave. If you confess your sins, 1 John 1:9, I will be faithful and just and will forgive you of your sin and purify you of all unrighteousness. It's not just for me, it's for all of us. Can we read that verse together? It's just so good. Can we read that out loud together? Here we go. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Bring your guilt to me, he says, with your eyes wide open, no stories, no excuses, no blaming. Together, you and I will agree you're guilty. You actually broke her heart. You actually lied to get away with what you did. You knew better, but you did it. Own it before a holy God. And then ask for forgiveness. And then you hear, you're forgiven, my son. You're forgiven, my daughter. And when the God of the universe whispers that to you, changes you. Changes you deeply from within. You are no longer condemned. It's as if he never sees it happening again. Why? Because it's paid for. It's done. It's washed. At Set Free retreats, when we get together and we do group, we do confession in small groups. One of the most powerful things when I went to my first Set Free retreat, they said, Dave, do not confess anything that you've already confessed because it's gone, it's done, it's over with. You don't have to keep on doing this. It is finished. In fact, I had to actually repeat the thing in our Set Free retreat. Do you receive the forgiveness of God? I do. Do you forgive yourself? There's always a pause there when I'm doing this with other people. Because often we want to hold on to something and judge ourselves more severely than God, the judge of the universe, has. But you know what? You forfeited the right. You forfeit the right to condemn yourself because you're not your own. You're owned by God now. You are not you. You are now owned by God, and he says you're free. You're free. When you become a believer, you give up a lot of rights. I am owned by God. Now you have to see yourself as your owner sees you, that you are forgiven. The evil one wants to move to define us as somebody that's shameful, and he will keep on poking. And so the guilt may remain. Well, will remind you, sorry, but it will not define you. Yes, I am guilty, but not condemned. And so here's how we're going to change the narrative. And this is the powerful part. This is the powerful part. When you feel guilt come up, start by saying, yes, I was wrong. I am wrong. I was an idiot. Just go ahead and admit that. Say, no, I was selfish. I was. But then say, I'm completely forgiven. I am completely forgiven. And you worship him for what he's done. A beautiful story in the New Testament about Jesus reclining at a table and a prostitute comes up with an alabaster jar. You know it if you've read the Bible. And she breaks the alabaster jar and spills out everything she owns at his feet. And they don't know what to say about this. And said, don't you know who she is? You know what Jesus says? This is so good. He says, the person who is forgiven the most loves the most. When we understand what we've been forgiven for, it leads us to worship. Those who have been forgiven most love the most, because forgiveness leads to worship. The person who is forgiven the most loves the most. I was just at a funeral of one of my best friends in high school, Harvey the Amazing Wonder Christian. His brother died. His brother is a pastor of his church. What an amazing, godly man. He did one of those videos, you know, before you die kind of thing. So you see the person who's, you know, giving the sermon on the... He was giving the sermon. That's just got to be wild, huh? To give the sermon at your own funeral. And so he's talking about, you know, he tries to smile. You can tell he's, you know, weak. And he, you know, tells about how he gets up every morning and spends time with Jesus. And he says, what I've done for the last 30 some odd years. He said, after he spends time with Jesus, he says he stands up, he raises his hands in the air and dances before the Lord alone because he's been forgiven. Every day for 30 some odd years. He raises his hands up. I've been forgiven. You saved me, God. I've been forgiven. And he does whatever he does, right? Those who have been forgiven a lot love a lot. And so instead of pushing it away, I don't want to, no, receive it. Say, yeah, full on bad, but full on forgiveness. Oh, God, you're amazing. God, thank you. And you turn it into worship, and you dance before him. If you could only do that every day, that's one of my take-homes from the whole thing about Howard's funeral. I got on my face today. I didn't dance. It was just not be good. And so I got on my face and I said, God, thank you for saving me. Thank you for giving me. You took it all away. You're so amazing to me. And it's awesome because when the evil one goes... Right? Because he does, right? He'll remind you. You were an idiot. Remember spring break? Okay. Now you take it and you go, yeah, I was wrong. Isn't that great? I was horrible. But God, you forgave me. And I am forgiven. And you turn it and use it for worship. It'll frustrate the snot out of him. It's awesome. The person who is forgiven loves the most. This is why Christians can be crazy vulnerable. Have you ever been around those crazy vulnerable Christians? It's awesome. One of the young men that stood up at Howard's funeral was one of those guys. He came up and he said, well-dressed young man. And he said, yeah, I was into drugs and alcohol. I was an addict. I came and I got gloriously saved and God took that away. And he used a little golf clap, you know. Then he said, you know, after a while, it just relapsed, and I just went back to it all. And I turned away from God. And you want it, I was waiting for him to say, but because it was this girl in my life. But he didn't. He just said, I turned away from God. But because the Christian community, especially Howard, just kept on reaching out to him. I come back, gloriously saved, he choked up. Those who have been forgiven a lot, love a lot. And that's the power of confession to your Creator. The power of confession to the Creator now makes you free to make restitution to other people. This is not just saying, thank you, God, forgive me, but I can keep on hurting other people. The power of confession to your Creator trickles down to others. Our marching orders is to love as He is loved. We don't go back to our narrative. We don't go back to our stories. But we go to Jesus saying, listen, thank you, you have forgiven me. I feel freedom. Who do you need me to go and apologize to? In fact, Jesus told a whole other story, didn't he? He said, you're going to go to an altar to sacrifice. But if all of a sudden God gives you the tap, God whispers, you need to get something straight with somebody. Listen to Jesus, right? You just listen to Jesus and you stop, leave the altar. Hey, you just stay there, lamb. You got a few more moments to live. I need to go and talk to somebody to get this straight. Why? Because the power of your confession to your Creator trickles down to others. We should never fear the consequences of confession worse than the consequences of concealment. Now, let me give you a few rules about this. A few rules about confession to others or apologies to others. All right? When do I ask forgiveness? When do I ask forgiveness of other people? This is really important. Ask Jesus in listening prayer. Ask Jesus in listening prayer because people will make you feel guilty. And you go, oh, I'm just going to apologize to everybody. It just empowers people who are guilt mongers, okay? Just hold on and say, God, what did I do wrong? Did I do something wrong? Do I need to apologize? Ask him. God's good at conviction. He'll tap and say, yes, you need to. Sometimes he says, no, you did nothing wrong. And then there's sometimes where he'll say, yes, you did something wrong. But you know what? This is just between the both of us. Sometimes there's internal things that happen. I've had some people say, a guy comes up and says, man, I don't know why. I just had this bout of lust. I saw somebody and, wow. Should I go and confess this to my wife? I go, did you act on it? No. Just take that to God. Just don't keep going to your wife saying, I'm that person and that person. No, that's not going to help. Can you just go really get this set with your wife? I've had people come up to me and they'll say, Dave, I've hated you for 5 years. Thank you. What did I do? Oh, nothing. You remind me of your father, my father. Thanks for telling me. I feel really good about that. You can talk to Jesus about that. Internal things you can talk to him about. But if God does tap you and say you need to get something straight for your 1%, 10%, go and do that without narrative. I'm going to ask our worship team to come on up, and I'll tell you about one of the best days I had to apologize for. It's a good one if you've been around Church Rock Walk for a long time. I've told the story before, but when you get a good story, it's hard to let that one go. Oh, man. It was the last day of my university. I went to a Christian university where you're not allowed to drink, dance, or go with girls that do. I don't know. We signed off, and we couldn't do these things, right? And the last day, my roommate came back drunk, quite drunk. And Helen, my fiance, was there, and he said some very disturbing things about her. And so I'm just in a rage. I went and picked him up and drove him through a wall. Isn't that awesome? Your pastor, fully forgiven. So it wasn't fully through wall, drywall, and I cracked a couple studs. That doesn't count, does it? So that's the last time I saw him, went home. We're good, right? Then I go to Jesus. I go, Jesus, I was an idiot. Forgive me. David, you are forgiven. But it didn't go away. So what do you want me to do with that? And He lives in California. I live here. He was drunk. It's okay. He said bad things. You know what Jesus said? Call him, Dave, for your part. That took me a couple months. I dialed him a few times. That was way back when we had those things. And then hung up every time. But finally, when I got a hold of him, I said, hey, Rob, it's Dave. You know, on the other side.
Yeah.
I said, the last time I saw you, I was an idiot. I treated you with no respect. I'm sorry. That was wrong of me. Will you forgive me? No narrative. On the other end of the line, he said, sure, yeah. I waited a full 2 seconds for him to say, and I was, right? There was none. Okay, bye. Do you know the freedom I felt, though? You know, the weight that was gone. I was free. I was just free. So my past may remind me, but it does not need to define me. My past will always lead me to worship. My past may remind me, it will not define me. My past will lead me to worship. We're going to come into worship now, and as you worship Jesus for what he's forgiven you for. Spend some time at the communion table. Do I need to confess anything and confess it to Jesus? That's why we have communion every week. If there's something that is deep within that you need to get straight, and you just don't know if you can do it, ask God for strength to go and actually apologize to the people around you here. You know what else? If there's something that you just can't get, can't shake, go to the prayer corner. I will be there. The prayer people with lanyards will be there. And you know what? We have confession sheets, and we will hear your confession, and we will tell you what Jesus already has told you, that you are forgiven. And you will hear a human being say that to you, and it will set you free. So let's be free today, okay? No condemnation. We live under the law of the Spirit. Heavenly Father, thank you that you have real solutions for guilt. You just don't tell us to make narratives around it or to carry it, but you actually remove it. Oh, Jesus, you died on that cross to remove my guilt, to remove my shame. I love you, God. Thank you. Thank you for taking the weight away. Thank you for saving me. Thank you for calling me your child. Thank you that I am forgiven. God, lead us all in worship today in Jesus' holy, holy name. Amen.